While 19th century London was a place where dreams often met dead ends, one boy's curiosity would light up the world. We take electricity for granted today, but have you ever wondered who made these discoveries possible? Michael Faraday came from the slums and revolutionized physics. Born in 1791, Faraday grew up in a poor neighborhood south of the River Thames. Life was incredibly harsh, largely due to the Industrial Revolution, which brought a massive influx of people into the city, leading to severe overcrowding and abysmal sanitary conditions. Faraday recalled being given one loaf of bread that had to last him for a week, hardly enough to sustain him. But he received plenty of spiritual sustenance from his family's small Christian sect. Faraday learned to read and write at Sunday school. He barely had a primary school education. What he lacked in money and education, he made up for with an insatiable curiosity. He started working as a bookbinder at the age of 13, binding books hour after hour, day after day. The only perk was his ability to read every book he could get his hands on. The more he read, the more he understood what he lacked in education. He tried his best to speak well and made sure his friends corrected him when he didn't. One of his favorite books emphasized the importance of critical thinking and the crucial role of observation in understanding the world around him. This book deeply impacted Faraday, teaching him to rely on careful observation during his groundbreaking experiments. Growing up, he heard about the discovery in Italy by Alessandro Volta of the voltaic cell, or battery, which, for the first time ever, provided a continuous flow of electricity. Before that, devices like tinfoil-lined glass jars stored electricity but released their charge in a single burst. The idea of a continuous stream of electricity ignited a fire within Faraday. How could he choose any other career other than one in science? Faraday managed to snag a ticket to attend a lecture by Sir Humphrey Davy at the Royal Institution, where eminent scientists presented their research. A customer at the bookshop where he worked, William Dance, had been impressed with Faraday's passion for science and offered him a free ticket. Faraday was mesmerized by the lecture, neatly recording every word in his notes. He hoped to get a job at the esteemed scientific academy, the Royal Society, only to find out later that when he wrote to its president, Sir Joseph Banks, Banks, or perhaps a secretary, had written on the letter he sent, "No answer required." Faraday wondered if he was destined to bind books for the rest of his life. But then he got a break. The bookshop customer who had given Faraday the ticket to see Humphrey Davy suggested Davy hire Faraday when Davy was temporarily blinded by an explosion in his lab and needed help. This was just a temporary position. The only permanent opening Davy had at the Royal Institution was for a bottle washer. He had to fire the one he had for fighting. It was the lowest of low positions at the institution. But it was a foot in the door, and Faraday accepted. Davy recognized his talents, and soon he became a lab assistant, helping with experiments like extracting sugar from beetroot. Working for Davy afforded him a unique opportunity to travel across Europe, mingle with leading scientists, and open his eyes to the world. Quite the journey for the son of a blacksmith who had never ventured outside of London. He built a reputation as a proficient chemist, then the frontier of science. He analyzed the gases emitted by aging eggs, tested methods of drying various meats and fish as food for sailors, and isolated the organic chemical compound benzene. Then came bombshell news that turned his attention to another domain in science. Hans Christian Ørsted in Denmark had put a magnetic compass near his battery and was surprised to see that the compass needle moved. His discovery revealed that an electric current could generate a magnetic field. At the time, few scientists thought there was any connection between electricity and magnetism. The French physicist André-Marie Ampère then described the intricate link between electricity and magnetism through a detailed tapestry of mathematical formulas. These math models were completely foreign to Faraday because of his limited education. It was akin to reading Chinese. Yet his lack of education may have been a blessing in disguise. Since Faraday couldn't lean on formulas and equations, he leaned into his intuition and powers of observation. He had to do his own experiments to understand a topic, which pushed him to design experiments that others hadn't dreamed of. One of his early experiments showed how electricity and magnetism could produce motion. He stuck a magnet at the bottom of a glass container, then filled the glass with a conductive liquid. Mercury in his case, water with table salt in our case. He dangled a wire over the cup. When he passed an electric current through the wire rotated around the magnet. This rotational motion was due to the interaction between the magnetic field produced by the electric current in the wire and the magnetic field of the magnet. Faraday had built the world's first electric motor. Fast forward to today, and the legacy of this principle can be seen every time a Tesla glides past you on the road. EVs are descendants of Faraday's foundational work of turning electrical energy into motion. His friend and brother-in-law, George, helped with the experiment and recalled, "I shall never forget the enthusiasm expressed in his face and the sparkling in his eyes." Faraday, on the other hand, wrote in his journal simply, "Very satisfactory, but make a more sensible apparatus." He published his work in a scientific journal, which catapulted him to fame, much to the apparent jealousy of Sir Humphrey Davy, who was now being overshadowed by his former bottle cleaner. Faraday became a fellow of the Royal Society. His Friday evening lectures at the Royal Institution became hugely popular. He also began to give Christmas lectures for kids at a time when education for children was rare. The tradition continues today. Faraday emerged as England's leading lecturer on science. He was offered numerous opportunities in consulting that would have made him very wealthy, but he chose the pursuit of science over financial gain. While his professional life took off, his personal life blossomed too. He fell in love with George's sister, 19-year-old Sarah. They were devoted to one another their whole lives, which was an about-face for someone who was once pessimistic about love. Writing, "What is the pest and plague of human life, and what is the curse that often brings a wife? 'Tis love." They had no children of their own, yet lived rich lives. Sarah supported him in any way she could, ensuring he ate nourishing food and making sure he had time to relax after hard work in his laboratory. 10 years had passed since his famous electric motor experiment. Though he had made other discoveries in between, something was nagging at him. If an electric current could produce a magnetic field, could the reverse be true? Could a magnetic field induce an electric current? Many had tried, all but failed, yet Faraday persisted. His observations led him to a critical insight. It wasn't just the presence of a magnetic field that could induce an electric current, but the change in the magnetic field. Electricity only forms when the magnet is moved. When he moved a magnet inside a coil of wire, he induced an electric current. But when the magnet was stationary, no current was observed. This groundbreaking work demonstrated a two-way relationship. While electric currents can produce magnetic fields, the converse is also true. A changing magnetic field leads to the creation of electric currents, a principle known as electromagnetic induction. Consider Niagara Falls. The falling water turns big turbines, which then spin magnets around coils of wire. This creates shifting magnetic fields in the coils. And just as Faraday discovered, these changing magnetic fields generate electric currents. From there, the electricity is transmitted through power lines straight to your home. While Faraday's experiments were groundbreaking, it took some serious math skills, which he lacked, to realize their true potential. Enter James Maxwell. He took the findings of Faraday and others and translated their pioneering work into a set of comprehensive mathematical formulas, now recognized as Maxwell's equations. These equations elegantly express how electric and magnetic fields are intertwined, ultimately leading to the identification of electromagnetic waves, like radio waves, microwaves, visible light, and X-rays. This understanding later played a pivotal role in the creation of radios, TVs, and in due course, cellular communication. So Faraday's hands-on experiments, combined with Maxwell's theoretical mastery, laid the foundation for today's technological era. Faraday was deeply interested in understanding the fundamental nature of forces and finding a unifying explanation for them all. His faith drove his deep curiosity, as he saw the laws of nature as the handiwork of God, and by studying them, he was studying the divine. He speculated about the possible relationship between electricity and gravity, to no avail. Some of his peers thought his limited math skills made him ill-equipped for advanced theorizing. As the years passed, Faraday's cognitive abilities began to decline, making it challenging to produce work at the same intensity that once brought him renown. The strain on his mental and physical well-being showed in the untamed whiteness of his hair as he grew older. Nevertheless, he did what he could. He served as scientific advisor to the Trinity House, a historic institution responsible for mariner safety around the British Isles. During Faraday's time, lighthouses served as vital guides, quite literally signaling the difference between life and death for sailors. Under his guidance, electric lighting began to replace traditional oil and gas lamps. He was so committed to his work that even at the age of 70, he personally went to sea to test the reliability of the new lights. In recognition of his profound impact on science, Faraday was offered a knighthood which he turned down. He felt that he should remain plain Mr. Faraday to the end. Faraday did, however, accept a gift of a house from Queen Victoria, spending the last years of his life at Hampton Court in London. On August 25, 1867, Michael Faraday died of natural causes. He was 75 years old. His gravestone in London's Highgate Cemetery is modest, mirroring his lifelong humility and standing in stark contrast to his immense contributions to science. Despite his challenges with math, Faraday shined through his deep understanding and intuition about the natural world. Like Faraday, many of us face hurdles in areas we wish to excel in. If you'd like to improve your skills in math or any STEM topic, I highly recommend Brilliant, a website and app dedicated to learning math, computer science, and data science interactively, and it's free for you to try out. I really appreciate Brilliant's scientific thinking puzzles, which skips the heavy math jargon and helps foster an intuitive understanding of our world, much like how Faraday approached his experiments. I personally go through Brilliant's logic courses to improve my critical thinking skills. There's something for everyone, whether you're just starting out, want to brush up on what you already know, or are ready to move on to more advanced lessons. If you're ever stuck, you can view the explanation to see where you went wrong. Brilliant is free for you to try out by going to the custom link in my description, brilliant.org/newsthink. And the first 200 people to sign up with my link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription, unlocking all of the courses. Thanks for watching. I'm Cindy Pom.